Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yes.
I want to begin this morning, first of all, just grateful for the opportunity to be in worship again. After 2 weeks of vacation, I'm sure everybody thought I was gone. But I enjoyed the beach for 2 weeks, and it's good to be back in the swing of things. So, there's a lot happening around us in our world, and so I want to pause first before I read the scripture highlight for our sermon this morning and just offer a specific prayer. Won't you pray with me? Eternal God, we pause in the midst of our not always understanding what's happening around us to acknowledge that you are still sovereign. We acknowledge, oh God, that you are even working behind the scenes in situations that create confusion and misunderstanding in our world. We even, oh God, acknowledge the fact that when we can't understand it, you have all the answers. And in due season, you will give them to us if we remain faithful to the cause and the call of Christ. And so our prayer today is that you would prick each of our hearts to act justly and to walk humbly with you, oh God. That as we live out justice and live out love in our world, that we will stand up for those who continue to be marginalized and oppressed. That we will be the voice for the voiceless, that we will offer hope to those who have none, and even, oh God, that we would be the face, the hands, and the feet of Jesus, extending ourselves to humanity and blessing and praying and being who you have called each of us to be. This is our prayer today. We pray in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
I want to read just a small portion of the gospel reading from our selected curriculum for today. From Luke chapter 10, I'm going to read specifically verse 33 through 37, and then I'm also going to read Revelation 12:11 in our hearing. Hear now the words found in the New Revised Standard Version of the text. But a Samaritan, while traveling, came near him. And when he saw him, he was moved with pity. He went to him and bandaged his wounds, having poured oil and wine on them. Then he put him on his own animal, brought him to an inn, and took care of him. The next day, he took out 2 denarii, gave them to the innkeeper, and said, "Take care of him. And when I come back, I will repay whatever more you have spent." Which of these 3 do you think was a neighbor to the man who fell on the hands of the robbers? The lawyer said, "The one who showed him mercy." Jesus replied and said, "Go and do likewise." And from Revelation 12:11, these words we find, "By the blood of the Lamb and the word of their witness, they have become victorious over the devil, for they did not hold on to the life they had, even under the threat of death." I want to preach this morning from the subject, "Love is a dangerous road." Love is a dangerous road. Life is always made up of experiences and encounters which provide for us challenges to our faith, our character, and the testing of our spirits. Life's greatest wars are never fought on battlefields. They're never fought in environments where people are really physically at war, but rather they are fought internally in our minds, in our spirits, in our spaces, on our personal altars. Life's greatest wars don't occur in serious outward conflict, but rather the struggle of inward conflict to be who each of us are called to be. Life's serious conflict, the most serious of scars, are not inflicted outwardly, but rather inwardly, and the ways we think and feel about who we are and whose we are. Life is not only composed of those type of experiences, but it is also composed of those things that cause us to put a question mark after everything. Questions arise: how do we go day to day? What do we do? What next is the step to take? And where do we go? Who do we confide in? Where do we seek courage? Where do we find hope and joy and love and peace in a world filled with hate and rage? Questions that always lead
leave us with varying answers because each of us come with varying experiences. Who am I and what am I living for? We all have different answers to these types of questions, and when faced with life's situations, sometimes we've got to deal in the midst of the pain and the sorrow, the happiness and the joy, and just say enough is enough. This is too far great a battle for me to fight alone. I can't do it by myself. And so then I must draw on the thing called love. Love is a four-letter word and whose meaning in our world today seems so unclear. It is probably the most misused word in the English language. We abuse its use, we misuse it, we flip it, we flop it, we fake it, even trash it. It's a word that has little to no real value in our world, it seems, because we use it so loosely and carelessly. Because our world rathers to hate than to love. Our world rathers to separate than to come together. Our world rathers to create division than rather to pull on the strengths of our similarities. All of these things that our world does seems to be so opposite of what love really is all about. Yet so much of the experience of our mentor, Jesus of Nazareth, is rooted and founded in the expression of love for humanity and love for each one. How have we become so complacent with sending mixed messages of love? Enough is enough. How do we grow from this place, and what does love require of us? What happens when true love becomes a dangerous road to travel? How do we teach love that is spontaneous and unmotivated and creates a beloved community where people and humanity value each other's life? The beloved community is a phrase that was coined by Mahatma Gandhi and then made popular by Dr. Martin Luther King during the Civil Rights Movement, and he calls it a realistic, achievable goal that can be attained by a critical mass of people who are committed to love, not hate. For it is love which will bring the miracles in human hearts. Within the beloved community, there must be spaces and places for people to stand and say, enough is enough. Let's travel the dangerous road called love. Traveling this road, we will encounter injustice and ridicule, rival and persecution, hate and hurt, sorrow and tear, pain and pressure. We will encounter happiness and joy and jubilation. But we still are forced at some points on the love road to say, enough is enough. How do we go about loving our enemies on the road called love? Our text for us today opens and we encounter a pericope, a parable of Jesus, where he's being put on the spot by a lawyer. And those of us who've known lawyers or have friends of lawyers, all of us know that lawyers know the law. At least they profess to know the law in practice. So for a lawyer to come to Jesus, who should know the law of Moses, and put him on the spot and ask him these questions, it's almost insulting, I would say. If I were Jesus, I'd be insulted at a lawyer asking me about the law. And then again, I might just say, don't you know all of the answers? Aren't you the lawyer? But still, Jesus entertains him, the discourse, and he says to him that a man was traveling down the road and fell on hard times, and he was beaten and robbed and then left there to die. And the lawyer says, well, who was the neighbor? Jesus says, the one who showed mercy. Go and do likewise. But what happens when you're on the road similar to that between Jericho and Jerusalem, which was the road that this encounter happens in the first century church? The road between Jericho and Jerusalem was known as the Bloody Pass. It was a road that was winding and curving between two mountains, and it was about 15 miles in length between Jerusalem and Jericho. And those who traveled this road traveled it quickly because it was a road where robbers and muggers and thieves hung out to take advantage of those because it was so dark you would not see what was coming at you. And so the man on the side of the road, as the priest and even the Levite, you would think they would have compassion on someone. Certainly they should. They work for the kingdom. They work in the church. But what happens when the people that are in the church that should be protecting you don't come to your rescue? Love is a dangerous road to travel by yourself, and so the man is there left in his blood, lying on the side of the road, and a Samaritan who was known as the enemy of everybody throughout that time. Samaritans were not popular. They weren't friends of anybody. They weren't claimed by anybody. They were known as the mud of the race of humanity at that time. They were the people you did not associate with if you wanted. wanted to be considered viable, credible, or even somebody of good integrity, of good report. But somehow, someway, the Samaritan decides to have love on a dangerous road. A road, the bloody path, and it's so interesting that the word that blood has two different acting powers in our lives. Blood in the Old Testament would be defiling. A priest and a Levite could not touch blood if they were going to the temple because then they were unclean and could not participate in sacrifices. But isn't it strange that blood also on Calvary redeemed us and reconciled us back to God? So what is it about blood that has that power to defile and clean at the same time? What is it about blood that allows us to be unified? Because we all have it inside of us. You bleed red blood plasma and I bleed red blood plasma. Platelets, we all have them. We might have different types of them and we may only be able to use a certain type in our body functions, but we all have a unifying thing, blood running in our veins. And so when you encounter, when the Samaritan encounters a bloody man on the road, the bloody path on the road to Jerusalem, he stops and says, I'll take care of you. Let me bandage your wound. Let me wash you with wine and oil. Let me sterilize these places that are bleeding so that you might heal. Let me offer myself as a sacrifice. I know you don't know who I am, and you may not want me to be doing this because I'm a Samaritan, but I have enough compassion in a world that is reeling with hurt and shame and fear to stop and to have love. And so what do we do in our worlds when we're on the road between Jericho and Jerusalem and we have children who suffer with subpar educational experiences in our communities and we have people who are being exposed to HIV and STDs at alarming rates and we have people who are challenged because of who they are and who they love and we have people who are living in the margins of society always oppressed and never affirmed? What do we do on the dangerous road of love? What do you say? How do you respond? How do you act? It's no secret that this week has been an emotional roller coaster for all of us. But it seems to me that the sad saga continues to happen. There are certain persons who are consistently marginalized in our world, and we have to do something different than what we've been doing, because what we've been doing just ain't working. The road of love is dangerous, and if we're going to love, we've got to do something different on that road. We've got to reach out and touch somebody a little differently on that road. We might have to challenge systemic sin that continues to oppress and make people feel unimportant. That means talking to senators and governors and legislators. That means opening your space and your home and your life and yourself to affirming every child of God, regardless of race, culture, gender, class, and sexuality. The dangerous road of love calls for that. And so we encounter, after the Samaritan has done all of these things, he's helped this man, he has made him feel valuable, has put him on his own animal, carried him to an inn, we find the ultimate expression of love. Love in the Greek has four different words, four different meanings. The first type of love is eros love. It's a love that's sort of aesthetic. It's a kind of love that Plato talked about in all of his dialogues. Whimsical and romantic. Sweet nothings in your ear type of love. Then there's also philia, the type of love you have for a friend or someone that you consider to be a close companion of yours. There's stoic love, the type of love that a mother has for a child or a parent has for a child. But the love that we're talking about today on this dangerous road is one that we see in the expression and the life and embodiment of Jesus. It's called agape love. Yes. That no matter who you are and where you find yourself, you are never unlovable. Martin Luther King says in a sermon in 1957 entitled, Strangely Enough is Enough. He says, I remember when Miss King and I were in Jerusalem. We rented a car and drove the road from Jerusalem to Jericho. And as soon as we got on the road, I said to my wife, I can see why Jesus chose this setting for the parable. It's a winding and meandering road. It's conducive for someone to be ambushed. In his own way, Dr. King was saying enough was enough. And there comes a time when we must each face that same moment on this road where there are points where we don't know what to do. But we must act and love like a good Samaritan. Isn't it funny that our world needs the love that we have for them? For most of us in the room, the world has not affirmed who we've been for such a long period of time. And now we've got to be a good Samaritan. Slap me in my face and tell me I've got to love you. How do I do that? First thing I must do is look at myself. Look at myself and ask myself the question, how do I love my enemy on the road that's dangerous? That's a question that I can't answer for you. You can't answer for me. But you certainly can begin to trouble yourself enough to answer it. The second thing we must do, when the opportunity presents itself for us to get back at the enemy that has not loved us, we must not do it. There comes a time that we will always have the opportunity for revenge. It happens. It's the way the circle of life happens. But those are the moments where you must really live and be the expression of love and not do the expected thing. Love is not a sentimental thing to talk about. It's not an emotional thing. It's creative and it's expressing the goodwill for all people. It is a refusal to defeat any individual. When you rise to the level of love, you seek to defeat evil systems and people. Individuals who happen to get caught up in the system of love find out that there's so much more reward in the system of love than there is in anything else. So, to spend time preparing the sermon today, I realized that we encounter this parable in a weird week. This is the lectionary selection for the week. Is that not ironic? It's almost as if God is saying, I'm going to give you the elements you need to preach a sermon this Sunday. And I troubled as I shared with Tom and Jay this week, 3 or 4 times my sermon title changed. I was watching CNN, I'm like, oh God, no, I've got to mention this now. Then I got to the place where I said, if I just talk about love, if I just deal with the idea of love, love that reaches to the highest mountain, love that flows to the lowest valley, love that lifts, love that keeps, love that stirs, because when you love enough, things won't settle inside of you that are bad. When you love humanity, when you love God enough, things evilly happening in the world, you just can't stand by and watch. Something has to stir on inside of you to make you do something different. This parable not only calls us to deal with love, but it also causes us to deal with racism. Racism that we must seek for justice for, offer assistance to those in need regardless of the group in which they belong. I said it before, Samaritans weren't popular with anybody in that time. But also Samaritans were people that Jesus had several encounters with. There was a Samaritan woman at the well. There are the 10 lepers, and the only one that came back to say thank you after being healed was a Samaritan. There's a Samaritan road, Good Samaritan's experience on the road to Jericho. Something about dealing with those who the world puts aside. Jesus is famous for dealing in that way and showing love to all. The dangerous road of love challenges us to take courage, even in the midst of what appears to be death. Will you put yourself in danger that someone else might experience a godly life? What will you take for your journey for love? Will you take love and compassion? Will you take the gifts and the graces God has given you? Will you take those things that you aren't sure how to use just yet, but you think they might come in handy? I look into your eyes and I look into the eyes of all of those around me, and I can say now for sure with the godly love that I love you. I would rather die than to hate you. And I'm just foolish enough to believe that the power of love can still conquer all evil. That's how we achieve the beloved community. That's how we love on a dangerous road. We jump in head first, get our feet wet, and just do. Because we dare to travel the dangerous road of love, we dare to be vulnerable and victorious, faithful and fearless, agitating and affirming. Because we dare to live in the power and the love of good Samaritans, we are able to shake the hinges of the gates of our world that try to so easily continue to press, oppress, sadden, and take advantage of those who aren't strong enough to speak for themselves. We must be able to share our testimonies rooted in love on the dangerous road we travel, that all might be free to live in the fullness of life and spirit. I'm reminded of a hymn that I heard growing up as a little boy in the Pentecostal church in South Carolina. I was sinking deep in sin, far from the peaceful shore, very deeply stained within, sinking to rise no more. But the master of the sea heard my despairing cry, and from the waters lifted me. Now safe am I. Love lifted me. Love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me. Souls in dangers, look above. Jesus completely saves. He will guide you by his love out of the angry waves. But the master of the sea billows his will obey. He, our Savior, wants to be. Be saved and loved today. Love lifted me. Love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me. Pray with me. Oh God, help us in life and living in all of our attitudes to work out the controlling force of love. The controlling power to solve every problem that we confront in every area. Help us to live on the dangerous road of love and a way that affirms your humanity. God, we know that sometimes we don't have the strength nor the resources to make it down the road alone. So allow us to unite those who are willing to travel with us. Love deeply, care graciously, offer hope to someone else. And when we encounter problems on that road, oh God, strengthen us to strategize and to act, and prick us to do things differently to change the results. Our world needs us, oh God. So strengthen us by the power of your love to travel down dangerous roads. We pray in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.